Amen. That's good singing. Let's all bow our heads in prayer, and let's again seek the Lord's face as we come into His presence today, praying that the Lord will come and meet with us, especially around His precious word. Our Father in heaven, again, we thank Thee for another Lord's Day. We thank Thee, O God, for the health and strength that You've blessed us with to be able to come and worship Thee in spirit and in truth. We bow before Thee in the name of the Lord Jesus, our Savior, pleading the merits of His precious blood. And we thank Thee, Lord, for the One who died and rose again, the One who ever lives to make intercession for His people, even our blessed Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, we can truly say that we love Thee more than any. We thank Thee, Lord, and we praise Thee for ever reaching down and saving us and redeeming us by Your precious blood. Lord, as we come before Thee this Lord's Day, Lord, we're reminded of the Reformation. We thank Thee for Reformation Sunday. And, O God, we praise Thee for the great truth, Lord, of the just shall live by faith. And we pray in these days, Lord, that You would send us another Protestant Reformation. O God, not only in our own land here, but across Europe. Again, Lord, that You would open up the windows of heaven. And, O God, that You would pour out a blessing, such a blessing that there would not be room enough to receive it. We thank Thee and praise Thee, Lord, for the Word of God. We thank Thee, Lord, for the truth of the Scriptures. We know, Lord, that someday heaven and earth shall pass away, but Thy Word shall stand forever, will remain forever. O God, we thank Thee that the Word of God is forever settled in heaven. And we pray today, Lord, as we open up Thy truth, O God, that You would fill us afresh with Your gracious Holy Spirit. And Lord, we pray that even everything that's said and done, Lord, in this service today would glorify and uplift the Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank Thee, Lord, for every head bowed in Your presence. We thank Thee for every family that's represented in God's house this morning. We just pray, Lord, that You would come and meet us all at the very point of our need. How we thank Thee, Lord, for saving us, those of us who are saved. Lord, from the bottom of our hearts, we lift up our souls to Thee and we praise Thee and thank Thee for the day when You plucked us as brands from the burning and redeemed us for time and for eternity. We thank Thee, Lord, today that we're heaven bound, that our sins are forgiven, that we'll never be in hell, that someday we're going to see the King in all His glory. Oh God, we're so thankful, Lord, for Thy mercy to us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We thank Thee for Thy grace and for Thy mercy. We thank Thee, Lord, for loving us with an everlasting love. And oh God, we just pray as we come to worship Thee today in spirit and in truth, that You would meet with us. And Lord, we'd be very careful to give to Thee the praise, the glory, and the honor. We thank Thee, Lord, for the visitors that are in this morning. And we pray especially, Lord, for the young couple as they come to sing this morning, that You would bless them. We pray for the land of Romania. We thank Thee for the gospel going forth in that land. And we pray, Lord, even now, O God, that in the land of Romania, that many precious souls will come and trust Thee as their own and personal Savior. Undertake, Lord, for us now. We just commit our way to Thee. For us in Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. Hymn number 67, that's good singing. Let's keep it up in this second hymn. Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then wherever you go. Let's all stand again as we sing. Amen. Let's all stand to sing.
Oh,
Our scripture reading is taken again from the book of Genesis, and the Genesis chapter 39, please, for our scripture reading today. Genesis chapter 39. Over these past number of weeks now, we have been studying the life and times of Joseph, and we're going to continue that study this morning. But let's read some verses, and we'll commence our reading at verse 7, just to get the context of this passage of Scripture that we're reading. Genesis chapter 39 and the verse 7. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, "Lie with me." And he refused and said unto his master's wife, "Behold, my master wanteth not what is with me in the house, and he hath committed all that he hath to my hand. There is none greater in this house than I, neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" And it came to pass, as she spake to Joseph day by day, that he hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men of the house there within. And she caught him by his garment, saying, "Lie with me." And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out. And it came to pass, when she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and was fled forth, that she called unto the men of her house and spake unto them, saying, "See, he hath brought in a Hebrew unto us to mock us. He came in unto me to lie with me, and I cried with a loud voice." And it came to pass, when he heard that he lifted up, that I lifted up my voice and cried, that he left his garment with me and fled and got him out. And she laid up his garment by her until his Lord came home. And she spake unto him according to these words, saying, "The Hebrew servant which thou hast brought unto us came in unto me to mock me. And it came to pass, as I lifted up my voice and cried, that he left his garment with me and fled out. And it came to pass that his master, when his master heard the words of his wife, which she spake unto him, saying, 'After this manner did thy servant to me,' that his wrath was kindled. And Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were bound, and he was there in the prison. But the Lord was with Joseph, and showed him mercy, and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners that were in the prison, and whatsoever they did there, he was the doer of it. The keeper of the prison looked not to anything that was under his hand, because the Lord was with him, and that which he did, the Lord made it to prosper." Amen. We'll end our reading there at the end of the chapter, and we know the Lord will bless the reading of his precious word to all of our hearts. We are delighted this morning to have some visitors from Romania, and we want to give them a very, very warm welcome indeed. They're over for a few days now, and they'll be taking part in different of our meetings while they're here. And they're going to come along this morning, and they're going to sing a couple of pieces to us, and they're also going to bring greetings from their church in Romania. And I hope I can pronounce their names right, Christy and Adela. And you're very, very welcome, so you are here this morning. And if I haven't pronounced your names right, you can pronounce them when you can come up. But you're very welcome, and we'll ask you to come and sing. They're going to sing a couple of pieces and bring greetings. Thank you.
Good morning. We are Christy and Alina from Romania, from Timișoara Bethany Church. And we are very, very honored to be in the midst of your church today and be able to bring praise to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So we will sing two pieces. Each one of them, we will sing the first verse and the choir in English. We'll try to do that on the best of our abilities. And then we will not like to deprive you of the beautiful Romanian sounds, so we will sing the second verse in Romanian. But please sing along with us, so our Lord receives all the glory and all the praise. So we'll start with, "Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore."
Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Rejoice, give thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice and sing again, I'll rejoice. Al nostru Salvator, e drept și durător, El ne-a eliberat, suntem al Său popor. Vă ridicați cu laudă glasuri înălțați.
Amen. We would like to bring greetings from our church, and we would like to salute you with the verse that is found in Hebrews chapter 13. It's verse 8. It's our church's verse for a few years now. And the verse says, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. And we are so grateful and thankful for everything that our Lord was able to work through your churches, through Northern Ireland, believers in Romania. Pastor Eugene Groza started Bethany Church, and now Pastor Valentin Fert is our minister. They send you our love and our greetings, and may God bless you in every work that you do for the glory of His name. And the next piece that we will sing is "Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God, my Father."
Is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. That provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Și sori și amiază zi, și amurg și noapte, și cerul înstelat te laudă. În susor tăi zbor, în cânt de păsări, în toate simt și văd iubirea ta. O, Doamne, mărește, mărește mila ta, ce asupra noastră pe-a noastră cale. În tine am găsit un adăpost.
Thank you. Thank you.
Amen. May the Lord bless, and believe He has blessed those lovely hymns to all of our hearts. And continue to pray for God's servants as they continue with their visit. They're going up to Bush Mills tonight, so they have a bit of a journey ahead of them. But pray that the Lord will give them journeying mercies and bless them in the days that lie ahead. It is good to see you all in God's house today. We give you a very, very warm welcome. Especially to those who are visiting with us, we give you a very warm welcome. And those tuning in through the social media, and we pray that the Lord will come and bless us this day around His precious word. Just a few announcements, very, very quickly, please. Do remember the gospel service tonight at 6:30 p.m., and I'll be here in the will of the Lord to preach the gospel tonight, and our brother John Porter will be here to sing in the gospel service. And then immediately after the gospel service this evening, there will be the Lord's table. And of course, as we announce every month, the Lord's table is for the Lord's people. And that meeting will be preceded by the half hour of prayer, if you can come that little bit earlier and join with us in prayer. Tuesday night, the prayer meeting. And this Tuesday night, our brother, Mr. Johnny Jordan, will be here to take the prayer meeting. So do please remember that. This week, of course, being half term, most of the activities for the children and the young people are off. There's no little treasures this week, and there's no children's meeting and children's meeting plus this week either. And there's the youth fellowship. There's no normal meeting, but young people, you're going on a trip, and the bus is leaving here on Friday night at 6:20 sharp. So please take note of the time. Just in connection with the children's meeting and the children's meeting plus, just let me again announce that there's still folk needed to go on the bus. Now, there has been some come forward, some new ones come forward, and we thank you for doing that, but we need others when the meetings start up again after the half-term break. So continue to remember that, please, and bring it before the Lord. And Friday night passed in Banbridge, the inter-fellowship quiz took part, and Tondra Gee had a team in it. It was good to go along and to be there that Friday evening. And I want to congratulate the team for how well they did on Friday night. Those that were in the team are Sister Esther McKee, Reuben Hill, Ethan and Joseph Brown. And they certainly did very, very, very well. And I want to commend them for the study that they put in. And I want to commend Mark and Claire and Alistair and Joanne for the way that they trained them as well. Certainly very, 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 very well worth effort. And although they didn't win on Friday night, they did very, very well. And we want to congratulate them. Do pray for the young people. What an opportunity it is for them to study the Word of God. And certainly they studied well, and continue to pray that the Lord will bless our youth fellowship week week by week. Also on Friday night, there is a presbytery meeting in our church in Lisburn for our elders, and that will be at 8 p.m. Then next Lord's Day, the Sunday school at 10:15, and the Bible classes at 10:30. The services as usual, 11:30 and 6:30 p.m., preceded by the half hour of prayer. Again, I'll be here in God's will to preach at both services. And our brother, Mr. George Agger, will be here next Sunday night to sing at the gospel service. Remember the special week of meetings that we're having from Monday the 4th to Friday the 8th. The information, what the men are preaching on, and all the information is on that sheet, and there's still more at the door, I think, at both axes as you leave. But please pray for that week of meetings. And also remember our Johnny Jordan's ordination service, Friday the 22nd of November. Quite a number of names are already down for that, to go on the bus. If you hope to go on the bus, please put your name down today, please, for that special ordination service. The next Consider Christ outreach we've been asked to announce this will be on the 2nd of November. And if anyone would like to go down to the south of Ireland to give out gospel tracts and that Consider Christ outreach, if you get in touch with the Reverend Porter, he'll be able to give you all the information on that. Now, I think that's all the announcements. We're going to sing another hymn, and the offering is going to be taken up. It's hymn number 440, Teach Me Thy Way, O Lord, Teach Me Thy Way. Thy gracious aid afford, teach me thy way. And we'll keep our seats as the offering is being taken up.
Thank you.
Please turn in God's Word again to that portion of Scripture that we read earlier, in Genesis chapter 39. And with God's Word open before us, let us have a word of prayer again and seek the Lord. Pray that the Lord will come and speak to us through His Word this morning. Our loving Father in heaven, again we thank Thee for Thy presence with us today. And O God, we do pray now as we turn to Thy precious Word that You would give us a word in season. We thank Thee, Lord, for the Scriptures of truth that we have been studying over these past weeks. We thank Thee for the life of Joseph. We thank Thee, Lord, for the many practical lessons that we can learn from his life. We thank Thee, O God, for the truth that Joseph is a wonderful picture and type of our Savior. And O God, we pray in these days that You would help us, those of us who are saved, help us, Lord, to be more and more like Thee. O God, give us the grace day by day to serve Thee with all our hearts, souls, and minds. And we pray, Lord, for that work of sanctification to be done in our lives. O God, help us to grow in grace and in the knowledge of Christ. We thank Thee, Lord, for saving us, those of us who are saved. What a blessing it is to know that we're heaven-bound. And yet, Lord, how we need to live for Thee in this world of sin. Lord, keep us from sin and from sinning. We thank Thee for the example that Joseph is to us, running away from sin, turning away from sin. O God, in this wicked world in which we live, help us to turn away from sin. And help us, Lord, only to do those things in our lives that will please Thee. O God, that we might glorify Christ in our lives. As we look at the life of Joseph, how he glorified the Lord, how he lived for his Master and Savior. And O God, in these days we pray that You would help us to realize that we have only one life. It'll soon be past, and only what's done for Jesus will last. And Lord, wherever You've placed us day by day, in our place of work, or at school, or university, or wherever, Lord, that we might shine out in our testimonies for Christ. O God, help us, we pray Thee, to shine out for Thee. Bless us now. Fill us with Thy gracious Holy Spirit and help us, Lord, to learn from Thy truth this day. And help us, Lord, not only to be hearers, but doers of Thy word. In Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. Last time in our studies in the life and times of Joseph, we considered Joseph's temptation and how he overcame temptation. Today I want you to consider with me the false accusation that was made against Joseph by Potiphar's wife. This slanderous allegation that Potiphar's wife made took place after Joseph refused to sin against God and against his master. Indeed, after Potiphar's wife realized that Joseph was not going to yield to her, she took her opportunity to falsely accuse this young man of God. And let me emphasize again, Joseph was only a young man at this time, but he was a young man who loved the Lord with all his heart, with all his soul, and with all his mind. And yet we have here in this portion of Scripture this wicked, evil individual making this false accusation against God's servant. Look what it says there in verses 13 and 14 of Genesis chapter 39. And it came to pass, when she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and was fled forth, that she called unto the men of her house and spake unto them, saying, See, he hath brought in an Hebrew unto us to mock us. Now here's the false allegation. He came in unto me to lie with me. And I cried with a loud voice. As we come to consider this slanderous allegation against Joseph, I want you to notice very simply a number of things. And again, I pray that God will take His word and write it upon each and every one of our hearts. There's lessons here, child of God, for you and I. And I pray that the Lord will take His word and burn it within our hearts and in our souls. It is the devil's object in our lives, child of God, to trip us up. He wants to bring us into temptation so that we will fall and destroy our testimony. I pray that day by day in our Christian lives that we will overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil. And even in these days, that work of sanctification will be done in our lives. It's great to be saved and to know that we're on our way to heaven. But child of God, you and I, as we live the Christian life upon this scene of time, we need to live for the Lord. And we need to honor the Lord. And the only way whereby you and I, as God's people, will honor the Lord will be by obeying His precious, precious word and turning away from sin day by day in our lives. I want you to notice, first of all, the slanderer here, Potiphar's wife. She was the one who made this false allegation against this godly man. Potiphar's wife was a very wicked individual. She was an ungodly woman. And as you study this passage of Scripture and consider this slanderer here, there's a number of things that we learn. First of all, we learn this, that she had no love for her husband. That's the first thing I want you to notice. This can be seen not only because she wanted to sleep with another man, but also for the contempt that she had for her husband. She spoke of Potiphar in a contemptible way, actually blaming him for the situation that she was found in here. Men and women, the Bible teaches us here that this woman had no love for her husband. Look at verse 14 and see exactly what she says here about her husband. That she called unto the men of her house and spake unto them, saying, see, he. Now the he there is referring to her husband, to Potiphar. Here's what Potiphar's wife says about her husband. He hath brought in an Hebrew unto us to mock us. Here we have this woman, and she's blaming her husband for the situation that she's found in. And in verse 14, she speaks about Potiphar in a contemptible way. Now that teaches me clearly that she had no love for her husband. Look again at verse 17. And she spake unto him according to these words, saying, the Hebrew servant, I underline these words, which thou hast brought unto us. Again, she's blaming him, her husband, for the situation that she's found in here. What an evil and what a wicked woman this was. You know, men and women, the Bible exhorts us, those of us who are married, to love our husbands and to love our wives. Marriage is a sacred thing, so it is. In the eyes of God, it is a sacred union. And husband and wives ought to have love towards each other. I know you're familiar with these words, but let me read you them in the New Testament in Ephesians 5, verse 25 and 28. It says this concerning the husbands. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Verse 28, so ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. And there we can see the standard that the Word of God sets forth, how the husband is to love his wife as Christ loved the church and give himself for it. If we truly love our wives, those of us who are married husbands, then we will sacrifice for them, and we will cherish them, and we will do everything within our power to make sure that they know that we love them. And then in Titus 2 verse 4, it says this concerning the wife's love towards her husband, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children. Underline the words, to love their husbands. There's no doubt here when you study this passage of Scripture, as far as this slanderer was concerned, Potiphar's wife, she had no love for her husband. I don't know whether she ever had any love for him. I can't say whether she ever had or not, but certainly at this point in her life, she has no love for him. And notice also that not only had she no love for her husband, but she had no love for Joseph. I want you to understand that. Potiphar's wife only wanted to use Joseph for her own pleasure. Joseph was a servant, and that is all he ever was to Potiphar's wife. And this can be seen in how quickly she slandered him when he fled from her. Look again at verse 13, and you'll see this. And it came to pass when she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and was fled forth, that she called unto the men of her house and spake unto them, saying, see, he hath brought in a Hebrew unto us to mock us. He came in unto me to lie with me. This woman had absolutely no love at all for Joseph. She told lies about the man of God. Child of God, the Bible says, thou shalt not commit adultery. One of the Ten Commandments. Here was a woman who wanted to commit adultery with Joseph. Potiphar's wife was an adulterous woman. And I don't believe that Joseph was the first and only man that she had tried to seduce. Now, I can't prove that. I can't prove that at all, because the Scriptures does not indicate that. But I believe personally that she had tried to seduce many men. And here we have her trying to seduce this young man who was a man of God, a faithful servant of the Lord. And we must always remember, child of God, and indeed each and every one of us, that adultery is sin against the Lord. You know, there's a tremendous portion of Scripture in Proverbs chapter 6. In fact, I want you to keep your hand in Genesis chapter 39 there. And I want you to turn over to Proverbs chapter 6. And I want you to read down some of these verses here. Look at verse 20. Here we have the instruction of the Lord to each and every one of us. Look what it says in verse 20. My son, keep thy father's commandments, and forsake not the law of thy mother. Bind them continually upon thine heart, and tie them upon thy neck. When thou goest, it shall lead thee. When thou sleepest, it shall keep thee. And when thou awakest, it shall talk with thee. For the commandment is a lamp, and the law is light, and reproofs of instruction are the way of life, to keep thee from the evil woman, from the flattery of the tongue of a strange woman. Now look at verse 25, because verse 25 is a very, very interesting verse. It says this, lust not after her beauty in thine heart. Adultery begins in the heart. It does not begin in the act. It begins in the heart. You remember what the Lord Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 28. He said this, but I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Therefore, although Potiphar's wife did not commit the act of adultery here with Joseph, she had committed adultery in her heart. Oh, child of God, what a lesson there is there for you and I. We need to guard our hearts. We need to watch our hearts day by day. That's why it is so important that our hearts are in tune with God. Each day we live, from the moment we get up in the morning until we go to bed at night, and even throughout the night, how our hearts need to be in tune with God. There's no doubt that Joseph's heart was in tune with God. I believe that's the reason why he could resist this temptation here and why he overcame this temptation, because he was a young man who was walking with God, close to the Lord. And when this temptation came, he was so in touch with God that it was easy for him to say no, easy for him to turn his back, easy for him to run away from the temptation. But notice the slanderer. She has no love for her husband. If she had, she wouldn't want to have committed adultery with another man. She had no love for Joseph, and certainly also she had no love or fear of God. Joseph's wife, or Potiphar's wife, got her opportunity to turn back from her sin, but she refused. I wonder, did you notice that in verse 7? Look what it says in verse 7. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eye upon Joseph, and she said, "Lie with me." And he refused. He refused. He said no. And at that point, she had the opportunity to turn away from the sin herself. But she continued. She continued on day by day. Joseph told her that adultery was sin and against God, but she had no love or fear of God in her heart whatsoever. Proverbs 31 verse 10 says this, "Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies." Potiphar's wife was not a virtuous woman. She was an ungodly individual who had no fear and love of God in her heart whatsoever. She only thought of sin and sinning. What an evil woman she was. Oh, child of God, I pray in these days that you and I will learn from this incident, and that we will recognize that while temptation can come our way and will come our way, of that there is no doubt, when we live close to the Lord, when we seek the Lord with all our hearts, souls, and minds day by day, when we're continually in His Word, wanting to do His will, living for Him, then He will, with the temptation, give a way of escape. Thank God there is escape from temptation. And thank God, when we're living close to the Lord will give us that strength. But you can see here the slanderer. Child of God, we need to be careful how we speak of others. That's another lesson, of course, that we can draw from this slanderer here. She was making a false accusation. We can see that clearly from the passage of Scripture. But child of God, we need to guard our tongues day by day in our Christian lives. There's a portion of Scripture as found over in Mark's Gospel, chapter 12. Just turn over to Mark's Gospel, chapter 12 for a moment, and look what it says in the verse 30 and 31. It says this, "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment." Now, we're familiar with the first commandment, to love the Lord our God with all our hearts, souls, and minds. But never forget the second commandment. Look at verse 31. "And the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandments greater than these, that thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." And when we love our neighbor as ourselves, we'll not do our neighbor any harm. We'll not slander against them. We'll not say things that we shouldn't say about them. When we love God and love our neighbor as ourselves, there's no doubt that Potiphar's wife had no love for Joseph, no love for her husband, and no love for God. And that's why she could sin so easily. That's why she could transgress so easily. But notice something else here, because time's going on. Notice, secondly, the outcome of the slander. What was the outcome of Potiphar's wife's false accusation against Joseph? Well, very quickly, there were those who believed the slander, first of all. Although Joseph was the godliest man in Egypt, although he had proven himself to be pure and holy and honest, a man of integrity in the house of Potiphar, although Joseph was completely innocent, there were still those who believed this ungodly woman. For example, Potiphar's servants believed her. And then Potiphar himself believed her. Look at verse 19. And she laid up his garment by her until his lord came home. That was her husband. And she spake unto him according to these words, saying, the Hebrew servant which thou hast brought unto us came in unto me to mock me. And it came to pass, as I lifted up my voice and cried, that he left his garment with me and fled away, fled out. There's the allegation again, the false accusation. And it came to pass, when his master heard the words of his wife, which she spake unto him, saying, after this manner did thy servant to me, that his wrath was kindled. He just believed her. He didn't question her. He didn't question Joseph. He didn't try to investigate the allegation in any way at all. He just believed her. And there will always be those who will believe slander. Men and women, remember that. There will always be those who will believe gossip. There will always be those who will believe something that's said against someone else, whether it's true or not. And you know, also when you consider this point here, the outcome of the slander, you'll notice that an innocent man suffered because of the slander. Because Joseph here suffered. He lost three things when Potiphar believed his wife. He lost his reputation. Joseph was highly regarded in Potiphar's house by his master. We can see that in verse 3, and we have learned that already. But once Potiphar believed his wife, Joseph lost his reputation for a time in that house. He not only lost his reputation, but he lost his job. Now, although he was a slave in Potiphar's house, Joseph had been exalted to a high position. Joseph had been made overseer, and we can see that in the verse 4, and we've emphasized that already. But because Potiphar believed this false allegation against Joseph by his wife, Joseph lost that privilege. And then, of course, he lost his comforts, because verse 20 tells us that he ended up in the prison house. Take a look at what it says there in the verse 20. It says this, and Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were bound, and he was there in the prison. There's an interesting verse in Psalm 105, and it's verses 17 and 18, and it talks about Joseph being bound. It says this, you needn't turn to it, let me just read it to you. It says, he sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a slave, whose feet they hurt with fetters, and he was led in irons. And that teaches us clearly that when Joseph went down into Egypt, he was taken and cast into prison because of this false allegation against him. He lost so much. But let me remind you again, and we've seen this before, but let me emphasize it again. Although Joseph lost much, he did not lose everything. Indeed, he did not lose the most important thing. He did not lose the presence and the blessing of God. Even in the prison cell. Take a look at what it says in verse 21. As important that you see this child of God in the context of this passage of Scripture, look at verse 21. But the Lord was with Joseph. Not wonderful? And showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners that were in the prison, and whatsoever they did there, he was the doer of it. The keeper of the prison looked not to anything that was under his hand, because the Lord was with Joseph. And that which he did, the Lord made it to prosper. Oh, thank God. Although the tide again seems to be turning against Joseph, and we have seen this in past weeks, how Joseph's life ebbed and flowed. There were ups and there was downs, and again, here's another down in the life story of Joseph. He's doing so well, doing that which is right in the house of Potiphar, being honest, living a godly life. And then all of a sudden, because of this false accusation, he's found in a prison cell. But even in the prison cell, the Lord is with him. Oh, child of God, surely there's a lesson there for you and I. Men may slander us, the world may falsely accuse us, but the Lord will never forsake us. That's the wonderful truth that is found here. Joseph's character was still intact as far as God was concerned. And very soon God would exalt Joseph and use him in a mighty way. You see, God would eventually vindicate his servant. Child of God, slanderers may deprive us of some comforts for a time, but eventually God will vindicate the right. And that's the wonderful truth here, I believe, that we can see again in the life of Joseph. But you know, I want you to notice something else here, and this is really leading on from the second point. The third point is this. I want you to notice Joseph's attitude in the midst of the slander. Now, this is so important for each and every one of us, but especially for those of us who profess the name of Jesus Christ and say we're saved. How did Joseph react to this slander? What was Joseph's attitude at this time of slander? Well, his attitude was simple. He left himself in the hands of the Lord. He knew he was innocent. He knew he had done nothing wrong. And he simply leaves himself in the hands of the Lord. We don't read of Joseph trying in any way to justify himself, although he would have been in the right to do so. We don't read of Joseph complaining when he was cast into the prison, although he would have been justified in so doing. Rather, he accepts his lot and waits upon God to justify him. And that's the point I want you to see. You can read this chapter over and over and over again. And I would say to you, take the time to do that. But you will not read of Joseph uttering one complaint. You will not read of Joseph uttering one complaint. He leaves himself in the hands of the Lord. Turn over with me. Romans chapter 12. Turn over to Romans chapter 12 for a moment. I want you to see this, because the Apostle Paul here, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, has something very important to say to God's people. When they're falsely accused, look what it says in Romans chapter 12, verse 17 we'll read from. It says, "Recompense no man evil for evil." In other words, if someone does evil to you, don't pay them back by doing something evil towards them. Recompense no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves. You see it? But rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord." Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in due sowing thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. The Bible says the way of the Lord is perfect. There are things that happen to us, child of God, in life that we may not understand. There's times we'll find ourselves in situations where we're thinking, why are we in this situation? What have I done wrong? When you've done probably nothing wrong. If you're in the right, leave it with God. And God will sort it out. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. I will repay. Maybe you're here today and you think that you've been hard done by. Well, consider Joseph. Was he not hard done by? Doing that which was right, living godly before those in the household of Potiphar. And then all of a sudden, because he had done nothing wrong, he finds himself in a prison cell. He was well in his rights to complain, but he did not. He left his future in the hands of God, believing that the Lord would work it all out. And thank God, we have the benefit of knowing the end of the story, and we know that God did work it all out. And how wonderful he did work it out. But in closing, let me say this. In this respect, Joseph again is a wonderful type and picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. In 1 Peter 2, verse 22, it says this. Listen to these words here in this portion of Scripture. What a tremendous portion of Scripture it is. It says this concerning Christ, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, he reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. For ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls, who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judges righteously. And thank God, on the cross of Calvary, the Lord Jesus Christ died there not for his sins, but for our sins. Not for his wrongdoing, but for our wrongdoing. Thank God, he died the just for the unjust. And the Son of God, he never complained once as he went to the cross, saying he would not go to the cross, but he set his face as if it were a flint to go to Jerusalem to lay down his life a ransom for the many. And there upon that cross, he uttered no complaint. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep dumb before his shearer, so he opened not his mouth. Isaiah chapter 53. And thank God today you and I are in God's house worshiping the Lord, listening to God's word, enjoying his presence with the assurance that we're on our way to heaven because of what the Savior has accomplished for us on the cross of Calvary. My friend, I wonder, as we close this morning, are you saved? Have you trusted Christ as your Redeemer? The Lord Jesus went the whole way to Golgotha's brow, and he didn't utter one complaint. He died the just for the unjust. He died for your sins and my sins so that we might at last go home to heaven. But in order for Christ to be your Savior, you must come personally and accept him as your own and personal Redeemer. Would you come today? Would you trust him now? And he will save you. Child of God, let us learn from Joseph. And let us leave our lives in the hands of the Lord. And the Lord will continue to bless us and be with us, no matter about the false allegations of this world. May God bless these few thoughts to all of our hearts. Let's bow in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank thee and we praise thee for your presence with us today. O God, we thank thee for this chapter, this passage of Scripture. So much in it, Lord. Oh God, we just pray that you'll take what's of yourself and bless it to every heart this morning. And we pray, Lord, for those of us who profess thy name, that you would help us to be like Joseph. Help us to live in this world for thee. And help us, Lord, to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these other things shall be added unto us. Remember the dear unsaved, Lord. O God, may you reach down and pluck them as brands from the burning. Undertake for us now. Separate us in thy love. Keep your hand upon us till we meet again in thy will. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen.